Have you ever gone online and played with a cardiovascular risk calculator? And if so, have you wondered how they come up with these numbers? Well, in an earlier video, I talked about the accuracy of these calculators. And in another video, I actually compared my diet versus being on statins and how they affected my lipid panel. Well, I'm going to combine those two thoughts together, and I had some very interesting findings about these calculators. Stay tuned. To recap, in that earlier video, I talked about the 2015 study that found that the average overestimate from a risk calculator based on the 2013 pooled cohort equation, or PCE, ranged up to 86%. Well, in 2018, a new, more accurate PCE was released, but for some reason, it's not in widespread use. So let's talk about that. So what I did was I compared the results using a calculator that has a 2013 PCE behind it with one that has a 2018 PCE behind it. And I compared them against the 11 lipid panels that I discussed in my diet versus statins video. As you can see here, the overestimate or the difference between the 2013 and the 2018 equations does start to get up towards 80%. So the 2018 equation really addresses, for the most part, this overestimate problem that was found in the 2015 study. These pooled cohort equations were actually rolled out in 2013 in a guideline. And here's an excerpt from that guideline. I'm not going to get into the equations right away, but this excerpt is actually important because there's a lot of philosophical discussion in there that I think we would agree with. It is important to note that risk estimation is based on group averages, which are then applied to individual patients in practice, something I've been mentioning all along. This process is admittedly imperfect. No one has 10% or 20% of a heart attack during a 10-year period. Another thing that I pointed out. Individuals with the same estimated risk will either have or not have the event of interest. The event of interest is either a heart attack or a stroke. And only those patients who are destined to have an event can have their event prevented by therapy. Only a small fraction of trial participants have events, and only a fraction of these events are prevented by therapy. And in this case, they're talking about all sorts of therapy, but statin therapy in particular. Here we have a good jumping off point for an agreement with our doctors. I mean, here we have the American College of Cardiology / American Heart Association guideline. Your doctor ought to be agreeing with it, I would think. Now, granted, this is a 10-year-old one, and I haven't found the latest one, but I'm sure this still applies. This particular paragraph still applies. We both can agree. These things aren't perfect. I'm not going to have 20% of a heart attack. I'm not going to have 7.5% of a heart attack. And even if I'm in that group that may have one, only a fraction of that group can have these things prevented through a particular therapy. So that's our starting point with our doctors, because then we can, if we agree on that, we can start arguing about, well, my value system says it's not worth me taking a drug if it's only going to give me a 2.5% decrease in my chance of having a heart attack. It doesn't make sense for a 1 out of 40 chance. So let's first look at the 2013 equation and what's behind it. This is the one that the ACC AHA has on their website, small variation of it, but it's essentially this equation. It's the one that's known to be 80% too high. We'll get into why they might still be holding on to this calculation later. So stand by for that. So here's the equation. It looks very complicated if you're not used to looking at anything like this, and you won't see this equation written down in any paper. I looked at the guideline excerpts and I had to read it about 3 or 4 times and finally had to extract this from the description in there and come up with this. And then just to make sure that I had it right, because I wasn't sure, I actually programmed this into an Excel spreadsheet and I compared it to what the calculators give me, and it was spot on. They were giving the exact same thing. So I'm confident that this is what's behind those calculators. So here are the descriptions of the various different terms here. And basically it says there's a bunch of values: age, blood pressure, total cholesterol, HDL. And each one of these measures is multiplied by some coefficient. There's a certain number of measurements used. So all those are in that summation part up in the second exponent. And you come up with a value, and then you basically figure out what's the variation from what it was for the population as a whole. And then we calculate the risk from there. It's really not important to go into it any more deeply than that. But here's an example of the coefficients in the values that are being used. The men, white men are on the left, and white women are on the right here. And you can see they take the natural log of these various different things. There's reasons for that. If you're not mathematically inclined, don't worry about it. You don't need to know why. But we look at the age, they look at total cholesterol, they multiply the age by cholesterol, they take the HDL, they multiply age by HDL, your blood pressure, whether it's treated or not, I'll get to that, whether you're a smoker, whether you have diabetes. For women, it's a little different. You can see that they square the age for some reason. You know, they multiply 65 by 65 if you're a 65-year-old woman. So here's the 2018 equation. As you can see, it's as complicated as the 2013, a little bit less so than the 2013 equation, I guess. Different values, different constants. The idea behind it is the same. So what is that idea? Well, let's talk about that next. First of all, we have to understand that these equations are empirically derived. They were reverse engineered from clinical trial populations, and there's no theoretical basis for why it should be a particular constant applied to a value. I mean, the selection of the values was based on looking at the data and saying, well, these values seem to have the most impact, but by how much? Very hard to tell. So there's no theoretical basis for using coefficient whatever for age and a different coefficient for blood pressure. That's actually just the way it has to be. I'm not sure it's possible to have a theoretical basis. So what they did was they said, well, let's look at the data. We have thousands of people and see what seems to be the factors that lead to this and how much should we weight them. Hypertension, diabetes, and smoking all have greater impacts on risk than lipids. And in fact, if you have diabetes, that doubles your risk. Going to talk about that a little bit more in a little while. But what I found was playing with the calculator, if I gave myself diabetes, so to speak, there was nothing that I could do to my lipid panel, according to the calculator, to get that risk value back down to where it was with my normal lipid panel and not having diabetes. So that's just an interesting point that I'm going to get back to again in a little while. Here's some more observations. Your systolic blood pressure, that's the upper number when you get a blood pressure reading, achieved with a medication is not as good as achieving it through natural means. Kind of makes sense a little bit. So in other words, if you have a blood pressure of 120 over 80 and you got there because of medication, that's not quite as good, according to these calculators, as achieving that by way of natural diet, exercise, whatever it is that gets you down to that level or whatever level it is. Now, it's interesting because blood pressure varies for everybody from day to day by up to 20% from some reports that I've read. Well, if I change my systolic blood pressure in the calculator by 20%, my risk, my total risk could go from 7% up to 11%. Which gets us into, oh, you need a statin versus no, you don't need a statin, discussions with your doctor. Another point, diabetes in these equations is considered all or none. They don't consider HbA1c readings. And the definition of diabetes or the diagnosis of it comes when your HbA1c is 6.5 or greater. If it's less than 6.5, 6.4, then you don't have diabetes. Well, it doubles your risk. I mean, I looked at one set of data and the risk was say 12%, you add diabetes and the risk popped up to 25%. Well, you're not going to cut your risk in half by going from 6.5 HbA1c down to 6.4 HbA1c. It just doesn't work like that. So I'm shocked that these calculators don't include that. They seem to be really getting down to the nitty gritty on the lipid panel, and then diabetes is, oh, you either have it or you don't. Well, an HbA1c of 5 is non-diabetic. That's very different than 6.4, which is pre-diabetic but not diabetic. And the risk has got to be substantially different between those. And somebody with an HbA1c of 10 is obviously going to have a higher risk than somebody of a HbA1c of 6.5. The calculations, the equations don't take that into account. It's a yes-no thing. So now we're going to do a comparison between these two equations, and I'm going to use the lipid panel results that I presented when I talked about diet versus statins' impact on cholesterol or lipid panel quality. The blue line here is the 2013 equation, and the orange line is the 2018 equation. You say, well, it still showed a decrease. I mean, does it really matter? Well, this green line that I just showed, that's the line that's going to cause your doctor, if you're higher than that, to have a discussion with you about initiating statins. Now, if we were using the 2013 calculator and I said to my doctor, look, I just want to try diet first, and I came back with these readings later, he would say, you did a really good job. You reduced your risk considerably, but it's still way too high. You need to be on a statin. And they'll be browbeating you into that, scaring you into it. But if we use the 2018 equation, I don't have that problem. I'm below the line. So I have to wonder, why does the ACCHA online calculator still use the old equation? I don't know. I mean, if you have an answer to that, put it in the comments. It's interesting that the one place that I could find the 2018 equation was actually on a Merck doc website. Merck makes Zocor and Mevacor. They are statin sellers, and they are giving us more accurate risk information than the ACC/AHA. I would expect that the American Heart Association would give us better data than a pharmaceutical company. I mean, that's a pretty low bar to clear. I mean, just give us better or at least the same. They're not doing it. Not sure what's going on there. So now let's look at the statin results. And you see they're very similar. Statins actually drove me down faster. But I'm not sure that this equation is actually valid once you're on statins. Remember I said that when it came to blood pressure medication, a blood pressure achieved through medication is not the same as a blood pressure achieved through natural means? It's probably the same thing for statins because these equations are based on a pool of people who are not on statins. And I suspect that my achieving the lipid panel quality that I did through diet probably beats whatever was achieved through statins. Because with the statins, my total was much lower, but so was my HDL. And HDL is a very important component in these equations. So I really think that I did better by diet than I did by statins. So what's my conclusion? Why don't let a risk calculation in an arbitrary threshold, for example, 7.5%, impose statin therapy on me, or I don't allow a doctor to use it to impose statin therapy on me. According to the calculators themselves, any of these following will do much more for you than what a statin can do. First of all, if you smoke, quit smoking. Conceptually, very simple. I know it's hard in practice. I have a joke about a friend of mine who proved that it's easy to quit smoking because he quit 6 times last year. So I understand that it can be hard in practice, but if you smoke, you'll do a lot for yourself if you can quit smoking. Lower your blood pressure. That's actually a little bit harder because it's probably different for everybody and there's so many different causes of high blood pressure. Ken Berry has a good video on some of the things that affect your blood pressure within a day. For example, if you need to go to the bathroom before you test your blood pressure. If you have a home cough, you know, make sure you're relaxed for 30 minutes. Something that's not going to happen in the doctor's office, by the way. So you always get higher readings in the doctor's office. These next three can be affected by diet. Lower inflammation, insulin resistance, and triglycerides. And if you think that, well, you know, I'm not willing or I don't think a low-carb diet is the right thing for me, okay, you can at least get rid of the junk food out of the diet. That will go a long way to reducing all these things. Just get rid of the processed carbohydrate. Get rid of the ding-dongs. Get rid of the pizzas. Get rid of the cupcakes. All that will go a long way towards helping you. That's my take on these calculators. Still wondering why the American College of Cardiology / American Heart Association hasn't adopted the 2018 equation that's known to be more accurate. Don't know. If you have any ideas of why that might be, please leave them in the comments. If you appreciate this content, please like, share, and comment. Subscribe if you haven't subscribed. Hit the notification bell so you always know when I posted something new, which is every Friday morning. So thanks for listening. And if you haven't seen this video, I recommend you take a look at it now.